Welcome to Let's Make the Future. This episode's future trend discussion topic: the future of our digital society, with Amber Davisson, David Gunkel, and Oskar Triebe. Brought to you by Fling.Asia, urban drone delivery. Get it fast. Fling it. Fling!
Welcome to Let's Make the Future, everybody, and thanks for joining. Our topic today is the future of our digital society. How we'll communicate and socially relate in the future, how politics and media will look in an era of data abundance, and how this will shape society. In the second part, we'll focus more on the role of intelligent machines, how they get into our society, how they will be integrated or even become part of it. Let's start with a quick introduction round. I'm Daniel Valenzuela, currently coming from Munich, working here on the future of factory work.
This is Hossein Kohani. I'm currently meeting from Michigan.
My name is Sarah Thalen. I'm also coming in from Michigan, and I'm a sign language interpreter.
Hi, I'm Michael Curry.
Okay, so that's it with our regular panelists, and luckily we have excellent companion today to help us dive deep into the topic of digital society.
My name is Amber Davisson. I'm an assistant professor of communication at Keene State College. My research is in the area of digital ethics. I'm particularly interested in American politics and presidential campaigns, so how individual citizens participate in the campaign process, and then also how campaigns attempt to manage them. And I've also done work studying revenge porn and that industry and kind of legal questions, but also the larger social norms that surround whether or not we should be looking at certain images and how we should interact with them. Finally, I do work on online affordances, so I study the design and creation of social media sites and the way that facilitates conversations online.
My name is David Gunkel. I'm professor of communication technology at Northern Illinois University outside the Chicago area. I am by training both a web developer and a philosopher, so I sort of put these two worlds together to come up with a sort of synthetic or hybrid approach to looking at the emerging and developing technology. My area of specialization most recently is in robot ethics, AI ethics, and I've written a bunch of books for MIT Press, The Machine Question, Robot Rights, and things related to that. So I think the second part of the conversation is more tailored to my thing, but I can certainly talk about digital ethics and related social items.
We got Oskar, who's also one of our guests.
Hey, Oskar.
And it sounds like Oskar is here. Hello, how are you?
Hey, I'm fine. You?
Great.
Oskar, can you give an intro to yourself?
I'm a Stanford graduate student, currently taking a year off to work with several startups.
Okay, cool. Thanks. So I would say in the information efficiency through internet and eventually also through social media changed completely how media works today, because media companies are able to quickly understand how media is consumed. Companies start optimizing content and delivery based on that, so that we pretty much get a biased, sensationalist, almost addictive form of media consumption, or consume media addictively. Can I ask maybe you, Amber, what you think are the major resulting effects that we experience from a major change in media to society?
So one of the things that I find interesting in these increased efficiencies is that a lot of users who are becoming increasingly media literate have figured out how to take advantage of those to create their own spaces in all kinds of ways, right? So I see members of the alt-right that are spending a lot of time picking up what we think of as kind of defunct technologies. They're looking at technologies that they see that other people have stopped using, and they're picking them up to start using them themselves. And so they become pseudo-private spaces within like the public sphere. And then I also see them creating private spaces on sites like Facebook, right? So they figured out how to use the private group settings to find alternative spaces where they can interact. So as information is getting tailored, you get certain groups that are figuring out how to take advantage of that tailoring to create private spaces for themselves to have conversations within public platforms.
What's an example of a defunct technology?
I may get in trouble for calling it a defunct technology. Periscope was very popular for a while. It was just kind of new and neat, and everybody was really loving it. And then it kind of dropped off the radar. And about the time it dropped off the radar, I started seeing a number of members of both the alt-right and the men's rights movement start using it. And part of the reason they started doing so was that they were getting pushback for what they were posting on YouTube. So YouTube had been a space to post videos that were making a profit and also reaching out to larger audiences. And then there was a crackdown in terms of certain regulations on YouTube, in terms of pushing them out and like violating harassment clauses on YouTube. And so Periscope became a place to go where nobody was really paying attention to what they were doing.
Very interesting.
Amber, do you think there's a danger there? People feel this pressure to be private in their conversations and conduct their activities in a place that's not on the public web. Isn't there a potential for that data to be lost forever? I mean, the loss to history that would have happened if we didn't have access to historical figures, letters, books that they've written would be uncountable. And it seems like the medium that we're using to have conversations these days, it's one thing if it's on the public web where it's being archived by all kinds of different web crawlers. But if it's done in these more private places, is there a danger that this will be considered the dark ages of history when people look back on it?
I think this may be the dark ages of history for a lot of reasons that have very little to do with private versus public. But I can definitely I can definitely comment on the private and public aspect. So I'm not necessarily seeing these groups exclusively make themselves private. What I am seeing is that they're distinguishing certain behaviors. So a lot of organizing behaviors take place in pseudo-private spaces. So I'm thinking of sites like 4chan, which is an image board where information disappears almost as quickly as it's posted, right? And everyone posts anonymously, and none of that's being archived, right? So I'm seeing them do a lot of back-end organizing in those spaces, and that back-end organizing is the kind of work that they don't necessarily want the public to see. With that said, once the back-end organizing work is done, a lot of the campaigns that take place in very public spaces, right? So you spend time in more private spaces, organizing your message, figuring out what it is you want to do, and then you head out into public spaces almost as an army that is ready on Twitter to then launch your message and launch your campaign. And they're not always entirely, we think of anonymous spaces and then pseudo-anonymous spaces. I would classify Reddit as a kind of pseudo-anonymous space where people are doing a lot of organizing work. So yeah, we're losing it. We're losing track of a lot of what's happening. And it's requiring catching things just as quickly as they're taking place, which is hard. And I know there's a number of researchers, myself included, who are trying to figure out how to track behavior as it's happening. Because if we don't archive it, it's gone before we have a chance. I always approach the internet as an archive in my research, and I can't approach it that way anymore because so many of the groups I'm studying are using a lot of the unarchived spaces. So I have to archive it. That's my job.
How do you think that will develop in the future? Do you have any thoughts on that?
As an academic, I'm always uncomfortable commenting on the future.
Yeah,
so, okay. But I will do my best, given that that's what the nature of this podcast is. I don't think we're going to get any less polarized anytime soon, but I do think that some of the communities that are actively interested in polarization recognize that their behaviors can disrupt the other side. So I'm thinking of the phenomena we call shitposting that takes place in a lot of political conversations. So that's about walking into a productive political conversation and injecting what we literally think of as shit into it, right? Until eventually you make people angry enough to thoroughly disrupt the conversation. It's an act of polarization, but it's a moment whenever two sides are definitely interacting with each other, right? And oftentimes when we talk about the polarization of the web, we start to assume that everybody just kind of goes to their corners and stops talking to each other. And that's not what I'm seeing. I'm seeing active raids. I'm seeing one side going into the other side's corner and attempting to just break down the conversation completely, which is, I mean, probably just as bad, if not worse, than polarization, because it means that even spaces where you feel like you can productively have a conversation with people that you agree with have been completely disrupted. So we've gone from we're no longer talking to people we disagree with to we're actually even afraid to have conversations with people we agree with.
Amber, how much of this is small groups that are extremely vocal and active online attacking one another in these skirmishes that matter to them very much, but not to broader society? And how much of this actually does penetrate into tangible results in the real world?
That's a hard one. You're going to have a very small number of disputes online that are going to bubble up and become really big. It's worth noting that the conversation about whether or not Hillary Clinton was sick during the last election began as a fringe rumor on the internet that kept getting pushed by a very small group of people, right? Until eventually you have the mainstream media reporting on it pretty actively. And there are several cases of that. The whole conversation about whether or not Pepe is a Nazi or not began as two trolls on 4chan who thought it would be funny to call the Daily Dot and pretend to be white supremacists and say they were prominent white supremacists and explain to the Daily Dot, this news outlet, that Pepe was a Nazi, right? And that story, once it happened, a lot of other trolls picked it up and made a bunch of Pepe as a Nazi memes. And then the news media, when they went to research this Daily Dot story, suddenly find a bunch of Pepe as a Nazi memes. Then you have the alt-right who picks it up and Pepe becomes a Nazi, right? So these little internet rumors, not all of them, but every once in a while, one of them catches and you watch it create public discourse.
Do you also see maybe on a more behavioral level influence in the real world?
Yeah. When I bring up various political events in my classrooms, I have my students repeat back to me rumors from the internet. So I watch how a rumor from the internet bubbled up and showed up in mainstream media and then eventually walks into my classroom. It's becoming part of our daily conversations.
Okay, but also the style, how you argue, for example?
Not in the spaces that I'm interacting, but keeping in mind that a lot of what I experience is in a classroom, which is a fairly artificial space. We still have a lot of norms and decorum in those kind of spaces that I think are going to prevent the active hostilities. Also, I spend a lot of time teaching students the kind of communication environment we're hoping to exist in. So I think I experience less of it.
Okay.
Coming back to an earlier part of you were talking about public versus private spaces and people moving into more private platforms so they can organize and talk more freely. I got the feeling that you had a negative connotation with this happening, which I very much understand. If it's your job to document this, it makes it a lot harder. But what is your opinion regarding public versus private discussions, considering the development of a democratic society? What do you think about this? Do you think that this might be actually something that is necessary for the natural growth of democratic opinions and the further development of our society?
I think it's absolutely necessary. You notice the kind of negative valence that I have for a lot of this. And I should start by saying that I study some of the less pleasant parts of the web. So I think some of the negativity that I have comes from the fact that I spend time looking at some really unpleasant things. We're just going to put it that way. So that probably is coloring the way that I come to the conversation. With that said, there's a long history of what we call publics and counterpublics. A counterpublic is this kind of parallel space where groups who are not part of the majority can get together and refine their message. They can share ideas and they develop a kind of solidarity. So when they go out into the public, they recognize that they're not alone because the public sphere can be deafening. The majority can really feel like it is the only opinion. And so having those private spaces where you get together with others and you begin to realize that you're not alone are so important for any kind of social movement, whether we're talking about ones that we like or ones we don't like, right? For any movement, it is necessary to have a space where they get together and develop solidarity and also develop a message. There's a lot of language testing that goes on in private spaces, right? You practice saying your opinions out loud until you get better at articulating them, better at explaining them, and so that when you walk out into public spaces and those opinions are challenged, you know what it is you want to say. And so that whole notion of having private back-end organizing to test strategy, to develop ideas, is used by pretty much every minority group, and it's important. Any negativity that I associate that probably has to do with the nature of some of the groups that I study.
Amber, could I challenge you on that? Because it seems to me that what you're describing is how echo chambers are formed, because you have groups of people that get together and reinforce each other's beliefs and learn how to, quote unquote, refute the opinion of the majority and, you know, learn to feel comfortable in their opinion. And that has a positive connotation if their opinion is correct or is positive in some way. I'm not quite sure how to characterize it, but it also could be very bad. When I was in university, I was radicalized into becoming a vegetarian by some friends there and then read some literature and got that reinforced. But you can imagine that people can get radicalized into far worse pastimes than vegetarianism. And just in general, isn't that contributing to the polarization of our politics? The availability of finding that 1% of 1% of the population that believes your belief?
I think it's too simplistic to call any of this good or bad. I think these are ways that we develop messages. And you're right, like there's absolutely the potential that this, not just the potential, this is how radicalization happens, right? You're absolutely right. But whether or not that radicalization is good or bad is a much grayer area. I think I feel less comfortable making those kind of statements. I will say that most of us, I think, at this point, because you're not just thinking about the echo chamber of the internet, you have to think about the way the mass media functions and all this, right? That you're being told that this is the larger public opinion. You're being told that these are the major issues. This is what matters, right? And so somewhere between the mass media and then the echo chamber of the internet, you start to believe that you're the only one who has the ideas that you have. And so you just kind of sit there and be quiet. And I do think you have to find a safe space to voice your opinions before you'll voice them within a larger conversation. And yeah. I will also say that people being quiet is just as dangerous as people getting educated in echo chambers, if that statement makes any sense. People being quiet is just as dangerous as people being radicalized. Because if we don't know what people believe, then we have no way to have larger conversations.
Yeah, I agree.
We're all very vague.
I also very much agree.
Actually.
Yeah? Sarah, go ahead.
Yeah, so you're talking about the counter space and the public spaces, those being kind of like antithesis of each other, or there's one that's happening more the majority, and there's one, like you said, a safe, more private space, right?
More like little bubbles. Like, I almost think about them like if you had a big circle, and then the counter public are like little bubbles attached to the circle, if that's a...
Okay.
That's how I visualize it for myself.
Okay, and so what I want to know is, I feel like those bubbles, those little outside peripheral bubbles, have become almost the dominant topic in the larger public bubble lately. Like, every time I turn on the radio or I turn on the news, what I hear about most is what's being said on Twitter or a trend in one of these outside bubble counter spaces. So my question is, how, in what maybe even positive ways, if you don't want to say bad or good, in what ways in general are these counter spaces affecting the way the public discourse works?
So I would think about Twitter as a largely public space. I will start out by saying that. I would think about it as being a kind of public platform.
Okay. And
as we think about what a site like Twitter as a public platform does to our larger discourse, that is a complicated question, right? So we can talk about the affordances of the site, that it's encouraging us to have our conversations in these short little outbursts, right? We can also talk about the sheer number of voices on a site like that means that it's almost overwhelming, right? You feel like you have a lot of opinion just coming at you and you're trying to absorb it. And a lot of that opinion is being shouted. So as we think about the way these platforms are influencing our public conversation, it's partly about this question of public-private, and then it's also partly about this question of the affordances of how they function, right? So we can talk about Twitter, where you have a feed of just kind of everyone. You can talk about a site like Facebook that's then trying to filter your feed and show you just what you will be interested in. So those are going to give you two very different perceptions of what the public looks like. Either one of them is going to encourage you to communicate in a really particular way. Twitter is going to encourage you to say things really concisely, which means you're not going to be making particularly well thought out rational arguments. Facebook is going to encourage you to say things that are going to catch people's attention very quickly. And so that's also going to not necessarily encourage you to make these very long, well thought out arguments. I think all of these sites are actively encouraging clickbait, and clickbait doesn't tend to lend itself to rational or civil discourse. So there's affordances and there's ways of speaking on these sites that are doing things to the public sphere just as much as this question of public and private is doing something to us.
Thanks. That's super interesting. Can we now maybe get more into the topic of data and privacy in that context? David, that might be also more technical, and maybe you might be interested in saying something about that. But maybe to introduce the setting, we all have seen when we were in one corner of the internet doing one thing, and later in another corner of the internet, we basically see stuff that comes from a completely different corner from based on your behavior, and basically tracking your behavior and leveraging that to give you personalized information. And also even more, there's a lot of instances where people assume that Facebook is listening to them, because when they're in the conversation or when they meet a person, Facebook will suggest things that the other person is interested in, which might not be due to listening actually, but maybe also due to intelligence of the Facebook algorithms. Even more, Facebook can understand your emotions just by basically looking at your Facebook behavior. All this will become even more drastic when you look at cognitive APIs. I think Microsoft offers like a lot of services where you can basically on live video understand the emotions of somebody. So this will be obviously a very powerful tool economically and politically if you can understand people's emotions so quickly. So that's the one thing when we give intelligent machines data to do something out of it. But also there's the other side where we give data to create intelligence. Think of, for example, a translator that you can feed as input, as a corpus for a machine that can learn translating, and that person will then lose their job. So all this data business, we can agree that this is extremely valuable today. And I wonder if it will increasingly become so and how we should deal with that. So basically, will data become our most valuable asset? And if yes, how will we compensate users for data? Or even more, how will we trade with data? How will we base our society on this, or economy on this?
So what you're asking about are a number of things. First of all, you're asking about the existence of big data and what we do with big data. And when we say big data, we're not talking about data that's somehow large, but we're talking about sets of data that are so large that they can no longer be understood or even processed by human beings, and therefore need some machine implementation to even find the patterns in the data that exist. And then the other component you're talking about is the development of machine learning, especially unsupervised deep learning, where machines machines are able to find patterns in data that exceed the abilities of understanding of the human designers of the algorithm that feed the data into it. So you have, for example, Facebook's facial recognition capabilities, which use all the photos that you've ever put on Facebook as a way of training its AI to recognize human faces, and now can do so at a rate and an ability that exceeds what you and I are able to do as human beings. Or you have, for example, other kinds of things like Google Translate, which originally was just using statistical machine translation, but is now using deep learning in order to learn how to translate on the fly from user interactions with the AI and with the Google service. And so on the one hand, this is all very convenient and all very useful because it is creating applications that really make our lives easier, more convenient, and personalized. On the other hand, you have these giant warehouses of data at Google, at Facebook, at Amazon, at Netflix, that is data about us. And because the way the laws are currently written, both in the US and elsewhere in the world, that data, although it's about us, does not belong to us. The data legally belongs to the individuals or the organization that collected the data. So they are able to trade, use, and exploit the data in ways that exceed our oversight. And as a result, we are in a moment now where the question that you ask is a very important question. Who owns the data? Who controls the data? And how is it monetized? And who gets the benefits of the monetization of data at this particular point in time when this has become the currency of the sort of AI world that we live in the 21st century?
If I may follow up on this, I actually work in an AI startup. So I work with a lot of data every day, and I know what we are able to do with this. And seeing this and then seeing what's happening with our data and coming back again to the public-private discussion, the internet used to be more of a private space that has increasingly become more of a public space. Like even Facebook, where it's like supposedly more private, it's still kind of public space. And now this public space on the internet is more controlled by corporates, which then in return own your data. But at least in Europe, there is this opinion that your data should be your data. And now the GDPR is bringing a huge change, at least in Europe there, which is now regulating that your data is your data. Even if you've given it to the company, you still have the right to get it back and to ask them to delete it. So this will be enforced in May 2018. And because most of the people and companies are not really ready for this radical change in the way that data is being handled, I have started with some friends a organization to help people demand their rights and to companies to respond to this. And there's also several startups racing towards this to make use of this. For example, Data Wallet and Data Fund are both building platforms to put your personal data on, which you have claimed according to your right, and then make use of it and to offer it to other organizations based on completely opt-in. So I see a huge change happening in this space right now.
Right. And I would agree, and especially if you look at what's happening globally, a lot of the initiatives are coming out of Europe and not out of the United States. And I think one of the reasons for that is the different legal systems that exist in the EU and exist in the US. In the EU, there's an attempt to get out in front of the problem before it becomes a problem. Whereas in the United States, with the practice of common law, we will often wait until there's a lawsuit before the courts decide things and sort it out. So I think a lot of what is going on, especially in the sort of progressive thinking of this kind of challenge, is coming out of Europe and not out of the US. And I think you're exactly right. There's a lot of new things coming into the fold currently that I think are challenging some of the old assumptions about data and about the way we control it. Another thing I want to point out is that we used to think the internet was about us, right? We used to think that the internet was a technology of machine-mediated human communication. That is, when I used the internet, I was always talking to another human being and the computer just mediated my interaction. The internet has passed the tipping point. The majority of traffic on the internet is now machine data. It's not human data at all. We're the minority of users in the system.
It's a chilling.
Can I add one thing to this question of the difference in the EU and the US perspective on this? And that is that in the US, we have some very definite social norms surrounding privacy. The general belief is that if you are attempting to assert your right to privacy, it is probably because you are doing something wrong. So I think part of the reluctance of consumers to kind of push back and protect their privacy is a general negativity that we have surrounding the notion of privacy in the United States. If you are an honest person, then you should just be living a public life. And I say that not as something that I believe, but as what is a general social norm.
There's that component, and there's also the component that in the United States, privacy has very little legal basis. It's called a penumbra right by the Supreme Court, meaning that it has no foundation in our Constitution or in our Bill of Rights. And as a result, it is an indirect right that is very hard to assert because it always is trying to draw on other rights to try to assert the right of privacy. Whereas in other nations, there are stipulations for rights of privacy that we don't have.
thanks for all the input. I mean, that all proves how critical the question is just today about how also accountability and responsibility is shared and how government and private companies interplay and users interplay here. Does anybody have any strong opinions about how this will look like in 20, 30, 50 years from now? And I don't know how important the difference in politics from Europe and US will be in the sense how they make policies, because I would assume that in the long term, these would always converge, or mostly at least. I might be wrong as well. But yeah, does anybody have strong opinions?
About the privatization of data, I think the future I want to see is one that every individual is the owner of their data. The data can be their external data, that can be their network, like friends, pictures of friends, or there can be like biological data. It could be the heartbeat, it could be their signals coming out of the body. So I think in the future I want to see is that these are all assets. These are all like extremely valuable assets of every individual. But today they're being used without compensation, which I think the reason is that we are not developed enough as organizations to really understand the value. So the public doesn't know the actual value they're giving away to these giant corporations. So I wonder, how realistic do you see this utopian future that I want to see?
Well, I wonder if the way to structure this, Haas, because I love that question, I wonder if maybe we just go around the room and answer Dan's question, because I think that's exactly what he's asking and you're answering it there. So he's asking, what do we see in 20 to 30, 50 years? And Haas, you're saying your hope and maybe your prediction is that everyone will own their own data. And my prediction is quite the opposite, that in fact, right now, we're, I think, very well compensated by the corporations for the fact that they're using our data. And we're compensated by the fact that we get to use Facebook and Google for free and all the other services. And it's amazing. I mean, it's a wonderful world that we have access to this amazing technology literally for free. And sure, they engineer it to be super addictive, but that just makes it that much better, right? And what I found interesting, just as a slight preamble to my prediction here, I was asked to speak in front of a group of PR and marketing firms here in Southeast Asia about artificial intelligence and to predict its future. And they, I can tell you, are very excited about AI in marketing, of course. And for them, and I think for individual people, the utopia is that goods and services arrive in front of you before you even realize you want them. So if it takes surrendering our personal data to corporations to get that to happen, I just don't really see why we should really ignore the fact that there's a huge upside to that. And that's kind of wonderful to be in a world where that happens. And I wonder if it's pretty much impossible, short of a totalitarian government, to stop the collection of this kind of data by private corporations. So maybe we just go with it. That's my prediction.
I do want to take a moment and point out, when we talk about owning your data or not owning your data, that a lot of those choices are not going to be available to the public at large. I'm worried, as we have an increasing capturing of private data, what that's going to mean for social mobility, that certain people will be able to really control their data, to manage their reputation, to manage their social footprint, and that other people will not be able to afford the necessary resources to do that. And I worry about what that means in terms of how we make decisions about credit cards and loans and all kinds of other things, in terms of how we decide who we're going to hire in the future and who we're not. And then I also worry about what it means politically. I study revenge porn. And so if you are a woman who has those images available of you on the internet, not just that, but an entire history of people slut shaming you and talking about you in all kinds of negative ways that is available readily online, you are pretty much never going into politics. That is just not happening for you. And we've actually seen a couple high-profile cases in the United States of women who ran for office, and pictures of them were found online that were years old. And those pictures meant that they lost all political credibility. And so in all kinds of ways, I'm worried about what this archiving of data, this capturing mass quantities of data, is going to mean for the future of social mobility.
But yeah, because really even like the medical side of that, Amber, that's interesting. Are you saying not even just something as, you know, humiliating and socially out there as revenge porn, but something like medical data? Someone can make a judgment of how fit you are physically to run for office, or some grade you got 10 years ago.
If I am archiving all of your workout and all of your food data in terms of how you're taking care of your body, perhaps I can then sell that to an employer who decides not to hire you.
Wow.
Yeah.
But how quickly does society adjust to this? For example, you would think that people knowing your income would be a terrible thing, but Sweden discloses everyone's tax returns on an annual basis. And when I tell people this that don't know this, they're shocked and they think that it would lead to the breakdown of society or something, but somehow it works. Now, maybe they're a relatively homogenous, small population, but it does seem like, I wonder if society would simply adjust. Well, no comment.
So just to answer the question about the utopian scenario that we're sort of working out or talking about here, I think Michael's exactly right. Cory Doctorow says it very well. He says, when the service is free, you are the product. We are the product of Facebook and Twitter. And that is a different relationship to a service provider than we're used to out of the industrial era. And scaling to that understanding is going to take not only education, but also some consumer development in the way that we understand our position with relationship to these organizations that collect our data and use our data. But to get to the utopia, a couple of things would have to happen. Either you would have to have a massive user pushback in which users would organize and say, we're no longer giving Facebook our data. We're not going to participate. And getting people to say, we're not going to participate seems like a really high bar to cross. Another option would be that some government regulation would be in place. When Facebook and Twitter were called out to Washington recently, you know, it's that kind of thing where you get the providers of the service to be responsive to government oversight and regulation. And again, in different countries, that has different credibility. In the United States, I think it's a very difficult thing to institute and to get to work well. Another innovation that we're looking at is on the tech side. I mean, blockchain is one example of a decentralized self-regulating system to control data that would give each user their own crypto key, right? So you can do it either socially, politically, or you could do it technologically. And the debate, I think, is which mix of those solutions will get you to the outcome that you desire.
Anyone else with a prediction for the future?
I agree it's a mix of all three. But I think the importance, we are underestimating this, because the amount of data we are generating today, it doesn't really impact our lives today, but our abilities to digest this data and make use of this are growing at a really fast pace, as well as the kind of data that we are releasing about ourselves, consuming this kind of services. As you nicely point out, we are the product. I think in the future, this will have a huge impact on our daily lives. For example, like Amber said, your health data will have an impact on your employment, maybe also on your insurance. How you handle your friends will also have an impact on your job. So, for example, who do you know? Like, with whom do you behave in what way? That might be pretty important information for your employer to determine what kind of candidate you are for the job and how good your chances are to increase the company's networking abilities and so on. So you're not really realizing this, but this will have a much greater impact than we actually think. And now going towards the future, what kind of future society we will live in, this is a pretty open question, but I see two very big experiments being conducted today, one in China and one in Europe, which couldn't be more different. They're in China, they're trying to construct a score for everybody where it's very publicly visible what kind of person you are, defined based on your data, and they're centrally organizing and controlling this, which will impact all your daily activities, versus in Europe, where you are in control of your own data and you can define the scopes of who can access your data for how long, and you always also have a copy of it. So how this could play out in Europe would be that we generate, well, we have built the law, and now we can use these laws to build new ecosystems where people retrieve the data and have it then in a system where they have easy way to control it and for other companies to access their data, which creates a complete new opportunities for companies to enter the data market. So if a startup wants to build, for example, a better image recognition algorithm than Facebook does, if they were to convince all the people who are owning now their own data to give them access to this, they could actually do this, versus today there's no chance of doing so because Facebook is owning data. And I think also in the US is deciding now which side to go. And there is also some prominent lawsuits which are pretty important. For example, the one the EFF was helping defend a startup which was crawling LinkedIn data to then make predictions about which person an employer needs to keep an eye on because they might be going away soon. Where they actually won because they said, yeah, this is public data and everybody should be able to access it. So Europe is going a different way where it's not public, but people are able to give it to these startups. So it's also lowering the barrier to entry. And I'm really, really curious to see what way we go. And I think the experiment in Europe will largely determine also how the US will develop. So if the GDPR implementation will fail here, then probably we'll go the other direction in Europe and in the US. But if this succeeds, then we might actually be looking towards a more positive future, I believe.
You picked something up that Amber said earlier with regards to social mobility that maybe already leads us to the next part where machines are becoming part of society in the sense that insurances, for example, and Industry 4.0 in manufacturing as well, in many, many different areas, also Michael, you said marketing, basically the human operator already interacts with machine intelligence that he has around him and basically we could say maybe a team, which leads to the human operator thinking more like a machine and thinking less in terms of what basically humans to distinguish from machine intelligence. So you would have that insurances, for example, or also health insurances will exploit basically every piece of data that they have about you that might go away then from the social nature and from the intervention of the government that was originally intended. Maybe David, you can tell us a little bit about how you think machines will increasingly go into our society and how they will impact this.
Right. So I tell my students that they are living through the robot apocalypse that has been predicted by decades of science fiction. And I explain that the apocalypse doesn't look like it's been predicted. It's not these robots descending from the heavens with ray guns and attacking us and asking to be taken to our leaders. But rather, it's a slow incursion where every day a new algorithm, a new application comes into our world and automates some aspect of our daily lives in ways that we didn't anticipate. So the robot apocalypse is more like the fall of Rome, where one day we're going to wake up and we're going to say, how did all the barbarians get through the gates? Because we are inviting these things in all sectors of our economy, of our society, of our political spectrum, because they're so damn efficient and because they're so convenient to making our life and our world a better place to live in. But we've got to keep an eye on what is being automated, who controls the automation, and what that automation means for the kind of social world that we're creating. Because I think we're at a very crucial moment where we have the ability to decide just what will be automated and in what way. Unfortunately, a lot of the decisions are being made behind closed doors by organizations that have proprietary hold on the technology. And as a result, any kind of democratic conversation about the robot incursion is something that is difficult to participate in, not only for lack of education, but also lack of access to information, lack of access to technology, lack of access to political mechanisms to be able to have an impact.
Can I just jump on that and ask a follow-up? Because, David, you painted a picture where we're already in the middle of this machine revolution. What we're doing right now is taking what you've called big data and generating insights out of that to make people's lives better in many ways. But I wonder if this takeover by machines will take a qualitative leap when we develop artificial general intelligence, an agency with these machines. Maybe they won't need data quite so much to be useful to us. And I wonder if at that point, the massive economies of scale that we're seeing drive the centralization of data and of power around data right now, where you know Google and Facebook and Amazon are able to create these huge advantages, insurmountable almost advantages over any startup like Oskar trying to get at some data to be able to apply the machine learning algorithms. I wonder if the future artificial intelligences will not require so much data. I wonder if that will lead to a decentralization of this future in maybe a good way.
Yeah, so let's come at this in a couple of ways. One is the question that you ask about artificial general intelligence and you know the impending singularity moment, right? That's one of the ways people talk about this, and individuals like Nick Bostrom and others have gotten a lot of traction talking about you know how many years in the future now until the singularity comes and superintelligence is available to us. I think that's an important question, but I also think it's a distraction because if we only focus on artificial general intelligence, we'll convince ourselves that we don't need to do anything because, oh, they're not conscious yet. They're not the singularity yet. So we can just sort of get on with our lives and not really do any sort of critical work at this moment. And I think that really is a false sense of security because I think a lot will happen before we get AGI and all these smart systems and the Internet of Things and all the data scraping that's going on by the AIs at this particular moment in time are creating a new social environment for us that if we don't pay attention is going to radically alter our world in ways that we may not want to have altered. So I think it's important to focus on artificial general intelligence as a possibility. But I think it also is something that we've got to say, you know, no one really knows when or if that will ever happen. But there are questions we do need to ask right now that do affect the future and that will have a short-term 10, 20-year impact as opposed to a 75, 100, 500-year impact.
Yeah, David, I deeply agree with you. And I would also say that the talk about AGI is more of a distraction, because what we should really be talking about in the field of AI is the concentration of power to create and control AI algorithms. So assuming that AGI is still 10 years away, like it has been for the past 50 years and will be for some more decades, I think this is a lot more important, because whoever controls these powerful AI algorithms, which are generating a lot of value, has a lot more power and might even be more powerful than governments. So initiatives like OpenAI, which are trying to make sure that AI is built safely, are important, but also we should enforce more that AI researchers join other groups than the biggest ones, which are now picking up all the talented AI workers, so that we have less of a concentration of the power in this field. What do you think might be a way to prevent this power concentration, or do you think it's too late?
Yeah, it's a good question. In fact, at RoboPhilosophy in Vienna in a couple months, we're going to be talking about this in a panel that's dedicated to talking about the political economy of robots, artificial intelligence, and algorithms. Because I think a lot of the effort that people put into thinking about AI and robots looks at how do we control their decision-making behaviors and will they enslave humanity and all this sort of good stuff. But I think we forget about the sort of power structure and the social power that is enabled by who owns the mechanisms. You know, if the big question during the Industrial Revolution was who owns the means of production, I think the big question in the 21st century is going to be who owns the means of data collection and usage. And I don't think we're asking those questions enough. I think we need to really develop a very keen sense of the political economy that is being organized around these technologies and begin to recognize how the concentration of control actually is being more centralized, even though the networks in which the stuff operates is highly decentralized.
This is a great place to mention that there's a company, a startup called Beatmark, and they're doing exactly that to decentralize the ownership and privatize data. And the parallel they make is that during feudalism, land was owned by kings, and people working on the land and making the food were themselves, as we are, against Facebook. But then over time, people developed a society that each individual could own their piece of land, and that's the future they picture. And they have so far raised like $11 million, and they have their own cryptocurrency also. So I think this is a great example of some developments in that direction.
Yeah, Hoss, that's actually a really good point to point out. The blockchain technologies, that is like a move towards a decentralization, which is really interesting. And there is other startups popping up like SingularityNet, which try to develop such a network of AIs, which then can interact in a machine-to-machine way without any human interaction to deliver tasks, which I think might be a good alternative to, let's say, a central provider of such technology, because like this, many different people can build their own AI, which is good at doing one single task, and interact with other AIs who are better at doing some other tasks, and like this deliver a good service to people. But I'm also still skeptical of how well this will be implemented, as the space is still very young. David, do you have some opinion on how blockchain and AIs might interact in a productive way?
Yeah, it's a good question. The thinking about blockchain and its impact and usage by development in AI is still so incredibly new. We're just beginning to feel our way into it. But the press that has recently circulated around the rise of value in Bitcoin, I think, is bringing blockchain into the popular imagination in a way that makes it much more accessible to people. But, you know, the whole point of blockchain is to come up with a way to leverage what makes the internet good, the open exchange of digital data on a peer-to-peer decentralized network, and to remediate some of the problems of that network, which is trust and authenticity and control over data. And, you know, I think we have yet to see how this actually plays out with cryptocurrencies and other forms of blockchain implementation. But I think as a technological solution, it's absolutely ingenious. And the people who are developing it and examining its possible futures, I think, are really pushing it in brand new, interesting directions in all kinds of places, in medical data, in cryptocurrency, recently in art creation. You see it being employed in all kinds of different and new ways that I had never thought of.
There's a company and it is an organization called Neva Labs in Ireland, and they are aiming to make a platform like Netflix for news. So that it's a semi-centralized platform that adds some human intelligence to make sense of the news and filter a lot of fake news. Do you think, Amber, that would be an ideal approach to the current problem of the bubbles?
It's interesting you mentioned that, because as we've been talking about this last part, I've been thinking about not exactly what you're saying, but about a man named David Imus. I don't know if any of you have heard of the Imus map. Several years ago, this map maker in Oregon won the contest for, it was like a major cartography contest for his map of North America, or it was the best North American map is what he won for his map of the United States. And most of the time, that is a contest that is won by major organizations like National Geographic, or we're talking about major government organizations who are largely using data to generate maps. And he took the data to generate the map, and then he spent 3 years combing through the data and hand-placing all of the information. So he took the data, and then he figured out how aesthetically to make that data more readable to a human being. And it's this beautiful, when I bring the map into my classroom and I show my students, it is this beautiful combination of what a machine can do and what a man can do when they're working together. The machine does what it does well. It knows all of the information. But it was Imus who figured out how to make that information something that we could digest and use in a really beautiful way. And I show it to my students because I think there's something that happens when you can bring together human intelligence and machine intelligence. Machine intelligence is scary in a lot of ways. It's doing a lot of stuff for us that we probably should be doing ourselves, right? And I think it's also easy to disregard it because it's not human. And so we can say, oh, it hasn't reached that general intelligence. And so we're not there, so it's fine. And instead, I want my students to start meeting the machine halfway, to start thinking, this is what the machine does well, and this is what I do. This is the thing that I bring to the equation. This is my part of the conversation. And so for me, I kind of hope that's the future. And so when you talk about this platform that's going to use human intelligence to start seeing fake news, I think that is a beautiful moment going forward of here's what the computer can do well to capture all of this for us and help us see it. And then this is what we can do well to start to filter it and make it something that another human being can understand. So I guess for me, that's what I hope the future is some kind of collaboration between human intelligence and machine intelligence. That is my optimistic utopian future.
Nice. I love the map. I'm looking at it now. It's beautiful.
David, do you have a closing comment about our future society with machines among them?
There's a component of this that we neglect and that we're going to have to address now and even more so in the future. And that's the question of whether or not these robots and these algorithms have rights and social and moral legal standing. Most of what we've been talking about so far has been about the agency, responsibility, and accountability that rests in the organization or the mechanism and the way we worry about the effect it's going to have on us. But these things are going to have social position and they're going to have a role to play in our social world. And the question becomes, what is their social, legal, and moral status? Do they have any claim to anything that we recognize as being the right of the machine? I think this is going to be necessary for legal accountability because our laws require that players within the legal system have a kind of status, a kind of legal right, but also for social interaction. We need to know how these things factor into our world and what they mean for us. So I think robot rights, although it sounds crazy, I think it's probably a very important component of this conversation that needs to be explored at the beginning now, but even more so in the future.
Thanks very much. Before we wrap it up, David and Amber, can you give some information to our listeners where they can find out more about your work?
All of my research is available on the keen.edu website. So that's where my home is at this point. You can check out some of my work. I wrote a book on Lady Gaga called Lady Gaga and the Remaking of Celebrity Culture. I've edited 2 volumes at this point, so one on theorizing digital rhetoric and another on digital ethics.
Thanks. And David?
So you can find more about me and my work at gunkelweb.com, which is my website. And as for books, The Machine Question, which is an MIT Press book from 2012, and then most recently Robot Rights, which will be out in 2018, also from MIT Press.
I can't wait to read it.
Okay, cool.
I'm going to plug David's book on remix ethics, which has also came out at MIT and is fascinating. What's the name of that book, David?
That book is called Of Remixology, Ethics and Aesthetics After Remix.
So definitely some more books in our reading queue now.
I should just say thank you very much to Amber and David, and really Oscar as well, who's coming to us for the first time, for participating today, because I really found the discussion fascinating. Thank you.
I would like to thank you again all very much. We had a really large panel today. It was an extremely cool discussion. So thanks, Amber. Thanks, David. Thanks, Haas. Thanks, Michael. Thanks, Michael, as listener. Thanks, Oscar, and thanks, Sarah. Hope you all enjoyed it. So I wish you a good night. Thanks, everybody.
Yeah, thank you. It was wonderful.
Thanks, Danielle.
Thank you for bye including bye. Me.
Good night.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.
Let's make the future. Featuring the voices of Daniel Valenzuela, Hossein Kouhani, Sarah Palin, and Michael Curry. Also featuring Michael Oloranimo. Music and editing, Christian Peltonen. Visit us online at letsmakethefuture.com.